إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، during the last class we started talking about the fundamentals, the principles of Tawheed. And بعده يعني؟ طيب. And we talked about the importance of the topic, because we said a person might be praying, fasting, performing Hajj while unknowingly committing shirk, and all of these deeds will go vain, not benefiting him. So we need to perfect our Tawheed. Our old class, our old subject is about the first article of our faith, Iman. And tu'mina billah, to believe in Allah. What does it mean to believe in Allah? Last time we said that Tawheed covers three aspects. Tawheed ar-rububiyyah, which is about what? The lordship of Allah Azza wa Jal, maintaining the unity of Allah's lordship, that He is the creator, the sustainer, the controller. The second aspect of Tawheed, Tawheed al-asma wa sifat, which means maintaining the unity of Allah's names and attribute. And we talked about some of these aspects which we will be highlighting tonight as well. And the third aspect of Tawheed, Tawheed al-uluhiyya or Tawheed al-ibadah, maintaining the unity of Allah, worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal alone. And we talked about a number of things, like it's not just about praying and fasting, how about calling on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? There are people, as we will talk about today, claim to be Muslims while they are calling on the dead or calling on some of the pious people, and so on and so forth. So tonight we'll talk about the opposite of the Tawheed. The opposite of the Tawheed, which is the categories of shirk. Because our understanding of Tawheed cannot be complete unless we understand its opposite, the shirk. And it's very important to understand it, because Allah Azza wa Jal said in the Quran, and this verse is very frightening, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. So any of our sins, Allah Azza wa Jal may forgive our sins except this sin, الشرك, which is the gravest of all sins to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's unforgivable unless the person repent to Allah and come back to the Tawheed. So what does it mean, shirk? Shirk literally, معنى هذه الكلمة, sharing, partnership, and associating. That's the literal meaning. And Islamically it means associating partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This association might come in any form opposite to the Tawheed. It means it can come related to Tawheed al-Rububiyyah or al-Asma wa al-Sifat or Tawheed al-Ibad. So let's talk about them one by one. How shirk comes in al-Rububiyyah. Now, in Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, shirk may come in one of two categories, one of two kinds. Either shirk by association or shirk by negation. What do we mean by this? Shirk by association, we find many examples of this kind of shirk, even in the old kinds of religions. Like within the Hinduism, al-Hindusiyya, for example, they believe in the supreme being, Ilah Azam, but then also is called Brahma. Then they believe in other gods as well, who share the power and dominion with this supreme being, the Vishnu and the Shiva. The God who is the preserver God, الذي يحفظ, and God who is the destroyer God, So this is one of the forms of shirk in association, thus witness in the Hinduism, for example. Think of the Christianity. Christian believe in Jesus, the Trinity belief of the Christianity, the Father, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. So they attribute part of the power, the dominion of Allah Azza wa Jal to Jesus. They believe that Jesus has control over the judging day. So this is again, this is shirk in al-rububiyya. Azradishtiyya, the Zoroastrians, al-Majusiyya, again, although they believe in a supreme being, they call it Ahura Mazda, al-Ilah al-A'zam, is named for them Ahura Mazda, who creates everything good, Ilah al-Khayr, but also trying to purify Allah from attributing evil to Allah, they created another god, Ilah al-Shar, the god to whom all the evil is attributed. This is again a form of shirk in al-rububiyya. And we see that in many of the religions spread around the globe. Among the Muslims, is there any shirk in al-rububiyya? As we said, yes. Like those who are worshipping the grave, people who are in the graves, the dead. Although they are pious people, but calling on the dead, believing that they have some kind of influence over events happening in the life, thus shirk in al-rububiyya. For example, some of the sects in the Sufis, the Muslim mystics, their belief in al-qutub, al-awtad, and al-ghawth al-a'zam, these kind of rankings they have, and attributing to them that they have power over the universe, they control things with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's a form of shirk in al-rububiyya. So we underline here one of these forms that's prevailing in many of the Muslim countries, which is calling on the dead. We see that in Egypt, you know, people go to the tomb of Sittina Zainab, Sayyid al-Badawi, Sayyid Hussein, and so on and so forth. Or other sects who are calling on Ali ibn Abi Talib or al-Husayn, all these are forms of shirk in al-Rububiyya. This is the first category of shirk al-Rububiyya. We call it what? Association. The second category is shirk by negation. What do we mean by it? Those who simply deny the existing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they say there is no God. Atheists, they say no God. And this is unfortunately very prevailing and evident in our era, especially among those who are subscribing to philosophical schools, philosophers, people who are thinking of the world and so on and so forth. So in the ancient time, there are a number of forms of this type of shirk. For example, Buddha. Buddhism is a movement that came against Hinduism, came from Hinduism, trying to fighting back the caste system. You know the caste system in the Hinduism. There they classified people into levels. So Buddha came fighting against this caste system. And later on, reached one of their interpretation, one of their classes, denied the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Azza wa Jal told us in the Quran about Pharaoh of Moses. Pharaoh denied the existence of Allah and claimed himself to be the Lord. He said to Moses, as Allah Azza wa Jal quoted him in the Quran, قال لئن اتخذت إلها غيري لأجعلنك من المسجونين. He said to Moses, if you were to take gods besides me, I'll make you among the present people. And said to the people, أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى. I'm your Lord, the Most High. As we said, in the recent centuries, the 19th and the 20th, till today, philosophers came with the concept of the death of God. And many people, you know, believed in it. Especially philosophers like Jean-Paul Sartre. And the idea prevailed, especially after many people and schools believed in the Darwin theory of evolution, which are being taught in many of our schools. And those philosophers claim that the idea of God is a product of man. People created it, especially those in the royal classes who are governing and ruling people. They created the idea of God, so the oppressed people will be busy by this concept, so they will not turn to them. Among the Muslims, among the Sufis, the Muslim mystics, we find people went astray in this regard as well. Maybe you have heard of Ibn Arabi, Al-Mal Ibn Arabi. Ibn Arabi claimed that Allah exists everywhere. And whatever you see is Allah Azza wa Jalla. So that's part of this kind, that's denying the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So ash-shirk in ar-rububiyyah comes into these two forms, as we said. Shirk by association, so attributing some of the power and attributes of Allah of rububiyyah to his creation, and shirk by negation, denying the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In al-asma wa sifat, also shirk happens in one of two forms. Either shirk by humanization, meaning giving Allah attributes of creation. The attributes of the creation, giving them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is very evident in a religion like the Hinduism. You know, Hindus, although they believe in the supreme being, Brahma, but also they believe in millions of gods, over 330 million gods. And they have these gods manifested in created things. So you create something, you know, tangible things, and they claim that's God. Even in Christianity, they tried to paint pictures for God, giving God attributes of the creation. And we all know Michelangelo, you know, the great Christian painter, who painted Allah, God, you know, on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel in Vatican. And this picture is highly revered and respected by all Christians today. This is the shirk by giving Allah the human's attributes. Humanizing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is shirk. Remember, what's the rule when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his names and attributes? What's the rule that we need to remember all the time? لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. Now, the second category in shirk al-asma wa-sifat, shirk by deification, which is the opposite of humanization. That given creation attributes and names from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At the time of the Prophet ﷺ, we heard of these gods, Al-Lat wal-Uzza wa Manat al-Thalithat al-Ukhra, as we read them in the Quran. Now these names were derived from the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Lat from Allah, Al-Uzza from Al-Aziz, Manah from Al-Mannan. So these names were derived from the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another example, some sects of the Shias, like Al-Nusayriya in Syria, Al-Nusayriya, they call themselves Al-Alawiyya, but actually they are Nusayriya. That's the proper naming of them. Do you know those Nusayriya, Bashar al-Assad from among them, who are governing the country. May Allah Azza wa Jal grant the people of Syria close Fatah al-Nasr, victory. They believe in Ali ibn Abi Talib as God incarnate. Allah Azza wa Jal manifested in Ali ibn Abi Talib. So they worship Ali ibn Abi Talib. For example, the Ismailites, the Aga Khanis, they believe in Aga Khan as God incarnate, that God is manifested in Aga Khan. You heard of Ad-Duruz of Lebanon? You heard of Al-Fatimiyya? Now, one of the rulers, his name was one of the caliphs of Al-Fatimiyya. His name was Al-Hakimu bi Amrillah. Now, Ad-Duruz, this sect in Lebanon, believes in this Al-Hakim bi Amrillah as God incarnate as well. They believe that he was the last manifestation of God in a human being, and they worship Al-Hakim bi Amrillah. So all these are examples of this type of shirk by deification. Now, we learned at school, at college, Einstein theory of relativity. Do you know this is a kind of shirk by deification? How this? We have here doctors and scholars, scientists. You know, the theory of relativity of Einstein has a conflict, is conflicting our aqidah. What does the theory say? Do you know the formula? Okay, you know the formula that says energy is equal the mass times square of the speed of light. The theory says simply that energy can neither be created nor destroyed. It just transforms from a form to another. Remember? Energy cannot be created, cannot be destroyed. It's eternal. It's been there and it will be there. This is the attribute of whom? That has no beginning, no end. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when Einstein says that energy has this attribute, it's eternal, has no beginning, no end. It's always there, and it's never destroyed whatsoever. It's never been created, and it will never be destroyed. And we learn that Allah Azza wa Jal said, Allahu khaliqu kulli shay. Everything has been created by Allah. We believe there is the creator, Allah, and everything else is His creation. Right? So when this theory teaches us that energy has this attribute that is eternal, has no beginning, no end, that's shirk in tawheed al-asma wa sifat. بدكم تحلوها مع المدارس كيف بدكم تحلوها. And Allah Azza wa Jal also told us كل من عليها فان, that everything will be destroyed. ويبقى وجه ربك ذو الجلال والإكرام. It's only Allah who will be there only. So even this theory is a contradict of توحيد الأسماء والصفات. So these are the two categories of shirk in توحيد الأسماء والصفات. What's the first one? Shirk by humanization, giving the human attributes to Allah, you know, humanizing Allah, thinking of Allah in a human form, human picture, and so on and so forth. And let's always remember, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ. There is nothing like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what's the second type? Shirk by deification, which is the opposite. You know, given attributes of Allah to the creation of Allah. And think of Einstein's theory of relativity. Now the third type of shirk related to tawheed al-ibadah or tawheed al-uluhiyya. which is simply, we said Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, that all our acts of worship should be directed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the essence of La ilaha illallah, that we utter day and night. What does it mean, La ilaha illallah? لا معبود بحق إلا الله. There is no one worthy to be worshipped except Allah. So all our worship is directed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether that praying, fasting, performing Hajj, or our calling, or our love, as we addressed last time, ibadah has a broad sense, broad understanding. Implementing the deen of Allah, the religion of Allah, living by the commands of Allah, this is part of Tawheed al-Ibadah. And we remember the story of Uday ibn Hatim, when the Prophet ﷺ recited the ayah, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله. He said, no, they didn't. They didn't worship their monks and their rabbis. Then the Prophet ﷺ told him, they made the lawful things to them unlawful and the unlawful things to them lawful. So they changed the rulings of Allah subhanahu al-ahkam, the verdicts, the rulings, and they followed and obeyed them. And that's form of ibadah for them. Now shirkul al-ibadah has two forms, which is the major shirk, ash-shirkul akbar, that Allah Azza wa Jal does not forgive it, which is the essence of all the missions of prophets. Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا. We sent to every nation a messenger. What was the message he came with? أَنِ اعْبُدُ اللَّهِ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. Do you see here the affirmation and the negation, they go together? لا إله إلا الله. Nafyun wa ithbat. So worship Allah alone and abstain from worshipping anything other than Allah. So anything other than Allah is called taghut. So taghut doesn't need to be only idols. You know, if people obey their rabbis, monks, scholars, following them and changing the rules of Allah, that's a form of ibadah. Now, as we said, it's not just by the actions, even by the heart. Allah Azza wa Jal said in the Quran, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِ يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. The total submission with total love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the essence of ibadah, should be only directed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if someone loves with total submission a human being, that's a form of ibadah which will negate his ubudiyya. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us that people might be so loving to materialistic things to the extent when it comes to a command from Allah and their desires, they follow their desires. It means what? The love of Allah is stronger or the love of their desires is stronger? The love of their desires. Allah Azza wa Jal said, أَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَهَهُ هَوَى. Have you seen those who adopted their whims and desires as gods, following them? So let's remember the purpose of our creation. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. That I have not created the ins and the jinn, but to worship me, in the broad sense of al-ibadah. Now, with regard to ash-shirk al-asghar, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned us from the secret shirk. All people beware of the secret shirk. The people asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ما الشرك الخفي? What's this secret shirk? What's the secret shirk? The minor shirk. الرِّيَاء. أحسنتم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, give an example of الرِّيَاء, showing off. When a man gets up to pray and tries to beautify his prayer because people are looking at him, this is secret shirk. So what's the idea? Now this is very dangerous. Why is it dangerous? Because for the believers, avoiding the major shirk might be easy because it's very clear and he will be very aware of that, so he'll stay away from it. But to fall into the minor shirk, al-riya, is it possible even to the pious people, to the true believer? It's possible for them because it's in the nature of ours as a human being, we love it. We love to be praised and looked up by the people around us. We have that inclination, and Satan comes and capitalizes on that nature of ours. Therefore, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned us from it. Ibn Abbas described how secret this type of shirk by giving an example. It's like a black ant creeping on a black stone in the middle of a moonless night. Wow. كدبيب نملة سوداء على صخرة سوداء في ليلة سوداء. How could you spot it? Could you notice it? A black ant creeping on a black stone in the middle of a moonless night. Could you notice it? That's how secret this type of shirk. It's very difficult, brothers and sisters, in Islam. What's the advice? We need to take a great deal of carefulness and eagerness to make sure that our intention is purely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we start our ibadah, we need to work on our intention to be for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to keep it, because if shaitan fails to destroy your intention and ruin your intention at the beginning of the ibadah, do you think Satan will give up? Will continue. Maybe he'll attain his objective while you are in the middle of the ibadah. If it doesn't work before you finish your ibadah, if it doesn't work after finishing the ibadah, so you talk about it. Guys, have you seen me yesterday when I did so and so and so and so forth? So Satan will not give up to ruin our intention, because having riya attached to the amal, to the deeds, will make it go away. You know the story of Al-Imam Ahmad when he was on the bed of death? He was on the bed of death, yahtadir. And while he was, you know, sometimes passing out, you know, the people heard him saying, laysa ba'd, laysa ba'd, not yet, not yet. And when he woke up, the people asked him about him saying, "Laysa ba'd, not yet." What do you mean by that? Why do you say it? And Al-Imam Ahmad said, "Satan came to me from far away and addressed me, 'Oh Ahmad, you escaped me. Futtani ya Ahmad. You escaped me.'" And Al-Imam Ahmad replied to Satan, "Laysa ba'd, laysa ba'd." What Satan tried to do with Al-Imam Ahmad? To feel proud of himself. Wow, I escaped Satan. You know, to fall into this al-ujub, self-admiration, which will destroy the amal as well. So Satan is always there to destroy our ibadah, so we'll not benefit by it. Ar-riya is very, very detrimental to our righteous deeds. Therefore, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us this supplication, this dua: Allahumma inna na'udhu bika an nushrika bika shay'an na'lamuh wa nastaghfiruka lima la na'lamuh. Memorize it, brothers. Allahumma inna na'udhu bika, we seek refuge with you, O Allah, to commit shirk knowingly. وَنَسْتَغْفِرُكَ لِمَا لَا نَعْلَمُهُ, and we seek your forgiveness for whatever we don't know. That's about the three types, the three categories of shirk. Let's quick recap. What are they with regard to al-rububiyya? What are the two subcategories? Association and negation. With regard to al-asma wa-sifat, humanization and deification. And with regard to al-rububiyya, the major shirk, al-shirk al-akbar, and the minor shirk, al-riya. Now it's time to talk about something that's very important, al-barzakh. Al-barzakh, now this reminds us with the hadith. You know, in Islam we believe that Allah Azza wa Jal, when created us, extracted all the souls before being implanted in the bodies, in the tummies of the moms. All the souls. And Allah Azza wa Jal addressed them that I'm your Lord, and all the souls of human beings testified of the Lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A long hadith is called this, known as Allah's covenant with Adam. A long hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained in it this verse in the Quran. وإذ أخذ سورة الأعراف وإذ أخذ ربك من بني آدم. Allah Azza wa Jal drew forth from the loins of the children of Adam. من ظهورهم ذريتهم, all the souls of Adam, Allah Azza wa Jal made them to testify. وأشهدهم على أنفسهم ألست بربكم, am I not your Lord? قالوا بلى. All of them testified Allah's Lordship. شهدنا أن تقولوا يوم القيامة. So you don't have a reason, you don't have a justification to say in the hereafter, إِنَّا كُنَّا عَنْ هَذَا غَافِلِينَ. We didn't know about it, because Allah Azza wa Jal told us about His Lordship. أَوْ تَقُولُ إِنَّمَا أَشْرَكَ آبَاؤُنَا مِنْ قَبْلُ. It's our fathers and forefathers who associated partners to Allah, and we were just their offsprings. وَكُنَّا ذُرِّيَّةً مِّن بَعْدِهِمْ أَفَتُهْلِكُنَا بِمَا فَعَلَ الْمُبْطِلُونَ. Will you then destroy us because of their sins and because of their those liars? But the Prophet ﷺ told us in explanation to this verse that Allah Azza wa Jal, when they sent down Adam to the earth at Arafa, at a place called An-Nu'man, you know, draw out all the souls of ours as human beings, and this covenant took place at that time. And this coincides and supported by what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, that every baby, كل مولود يولد على الفطرة, that every child is born in a state of fitrah. This is the state of fitrah that the Prophet ﷺ is quoting. That deep in the heart of every human being, they know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if they were to be left alone, they will believe in the unity of Allah, and they will direct their acts of worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's because of the pressures of the environment, the upbringing of the parents, and that's what the Prophet ﷺ said, but because of their parents, فَأَبَوَاهُ يُهَوِّدَانِهِ أَوْ يُنَصِّرَانِهِ أَوْ يُمَجِّسَانِهِ. Because of the parents, because of the environment, because of the upbringing, so the parents will make them either Christians or Jews or Magians. So, I found this, by the way, one of the great ways when making da'wah to the non-Muslims. I'm calling them, I tell them, I challenge them, I'm striking them by telling them this fact, that deep in your heart you are a Muslim. It's just covered. Covered because of what you have learned from your parents, from home, from school, from the society, and so on and so forth. But deep in your heart, there is something calling you to come back, to turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what brings you to me today when they come asking about Islam and so on and so forth. So let's capitalize on this fact. The Prophet told us that Islam is implanted in the fitrah, in the natural state of every human being. So just we need to tap into it, to reach out to it, bring it up and water it. So show it to the people, guide them back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for this reason, because of the pressures around us, around humans, from time to time Allah Azza wa Jalla sent to human beings, to al-Bashariya, prophets and messengers, to help them out to come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Satan will always draw them, lead them away from the straight path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now with the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is no more prophets. But it's upon us to bear the banners of Islam and propagate Islam, show it to the people, as do the roles of the prophets, the ambassadors of Islam to humanities. That's very important of us to do. And this brings us to a very important topic, which is some people, I'm born in a Muslim family. Does that make me a true believer, just being born in a Muslim country, a Muslim family? Does that make me a better person than a person who reverted to Islam, converted to Islam? And this is something we need to ponder over. Because among the born Muslims, who born in Muslim families, they are so ignorant about Islam, or the practices they learn from their parents and foreparents are far away from the practices of Islam. And this is one of the challenges we are facing to oneself and with our brothers in the society. When showing them the practices of Islam as taught in the Book of Allah and as taught by His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you would find always one of the hindrances, the obstacles in the way of acceptance and approving is what? Inna wajadna aba'ana ala ummah. What does it mean here, the word ummah? That we found our fathers and forefathers on a way. The word ummah in Quran comes with four meanings. You know them? This is one of them. Inna wajadna aba'ana ala ummah means ala tariqah, on a way, doing certain practices. So don't ask of us to change these practices. Now, by Allah, you and I sometimes we act in the same fashion. We are Muslims, we pray, fast, and so on and so forth. I'm used to do things in a certain way. The way I learned it at school, the way I learned it from my parents, and for the past, for the past 55 years, oh no, not 55 years, for the past 30 years I have been practicing Islam in this fashion and this way. And brother Ahmad comes and say to me, but brother, there is an authentic hadith in Sahih Bukhari and Muslim that says so and so, which is different than what I'm doing. Now, how most of the people nowadays acting and behaving? Yeah, they wait till they hear that teaching from the same teacher back home or from my parents and so on and so forth. That's not becoming. Brothers, we need to discipline ourselves to follow the truth whenever we see it and whenever we find it. You know, and that was the teaching of Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah ta'ala. Abu Hanifa taught his students, إِذَا صَحَّ الْحَدِيثُ فَهُوَ مَذْهَبِي. When the hadith the prophetic narration is reported authentic, it's my way, it's my saying. So if you find anything which implies, if you find something I've said contradicting that hadith, put it away, and that's what I'm saying. So we need to discipline ourselves. We need to demand of ourselves to seek the truth, learn it. It's not enough that I'm born as a Muslim. There is a lot of learning we need to acquire. So to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the straight path in accordance to the teaching of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So how this covenant that Allah Azza wa Jal took on us to be fulfilled, we need to sincerely believing in the Tawheed, putting this belief into practice in our daily life, practicing Islam as taught by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and avoiding all kinds and all acts of shirk. I said there are four meanings for the word Ummah in the Quran. One of these meaning is way. Inna wajadna aba'ana ala umma. What are the other meanings? Anyone knows? Group of people. Ummatun min al-nas. Walamma warada ma'a madyana. When Musa alayhi salam came to the water, wajada alayhi, he found ummatan min al-nas yasqoon, a group of people watering their cattle. What's the third meaning? Wadakara ba'da umma. Yusuf alayhi salam, in the story of Yusuf, when he said to one of the people who were in the prison that when you are out, you know, mention my name to the king, and the person forgot. And when the king saw the dream and asked for an interpreter, that person remembered ba'da umma, after a period of time. So time. What's the fourth meaning? Ahsant, inna Ibrahim kana ummatan qanitan lillahi hanifan. What does it mean? Imaman. Imam. A great person, pious, to be followed and learned from. طيب. زاكم الله خيرا. So what did we learn today, tonight? Quick recap. We learned, the last class we learned the three categories of Tawheed. This night we learned the three categories of Shirk, the opposite of the Tawheed. With regard to Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, the two subcategories, al-Rububiyyah, association and negation. With regard to Tawheed al-Asma wa al-Sifat, humanization and deification. With regard to Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, al-Shirk al-Akbar, and the minor Shirk al-Riyah. May Allah Azza wa Jal protect us from all of this. And we spoke about Allah's covenant to Adam and all of us, and we learned how to fulfill this covenant by applying Tawheed and avoiding Shirk, by leading our life in according to the teachings of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So all our righteous deeds should be as taught by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In our way, while we're coming, someone was passing by and he was dressed in a certain way. So I said to my daughter-in-law, this is from a deviant sect. And she said to me, yeah, I know. All I know that they are bad, and to avoid them. That's good. We need to know the wrong ways, so to avoid them. That's very essential. And that's what we have learned. We learned the Tawheed, the way to God, and we learn the opposite of the Tawheed to avoid it. We don't want to commit any kinds of these shirks. I beg of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make me and you from among those who are fulfilling the covenants of Allah, applying the Tawheed and avoiding all types of shirk, protecting our hearts from al-riya, showing off, so to make all our righteous deeds for Him alone subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you have any question about our subject tonight or what we have introduced last night, the previous class?
Yes, sir, the mic was question. Sometimes it's happening, for example, a man or boy goes to the street.
What's that?
Suddenly a car coming. And the other guy moved him very quickly and he saved him from accident. In the same time, they say, the guy says, thank you very much. In the same quick time, he forget that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just he said, thank you very much, you saved me. But it's complicated sometimes. When you go to the hadith, you have to say, man, ya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Okay. So what's your question?
Not the fact it's contradicting like you know submission to Allah. Allah is thanking the man.
Now thanking the question of the brothers was he gave an example for our sisters that someone was about to be hit by a car and someone else you know saved him and so he started thanking him. How that you know thanking is a must. Man la yashkur in nas la yashkur illah. But there is a subtle issue here that deep in our heart we need always to remember it's Allah who is the controller. It's Allah who caused this person to be there and to act promptly to pull you out from that accident. So that person was a means. You thank him for what he did, but in your heart you are attributing this to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is very important. So, and there is no contradict between the two. Any other question?
You mentioned about the atheist, there's another group agnostic.
Agnostic, yes.
Don't know. Atheist deny, but agnostic say,
and that's a form of denial. If you think about it, they end up in the same pool. Yeah, they are denying the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether they say it utterly with boldness or whether they say it in a soft tone, we don't know. That's a soft tone of denying. But end of the day, it's denying.
We're
going to
talk about the theory of Big Bang. Because we know that the science discovered that at very past, very long past, at one time there is something that this universe started from.
Allah Azza wa Jal started it at that.
Then, when as a Muslim, we can say it's that time, the moment of the creation. Allah Ta'ala could say, could he create this unit? I mean, there is no contradiction our belief with the theory of Big Bang.
We didn't mention anything about the Big Bang thing. To the contrary, you read in the Muslim scientists who talk about the miracles in the Quran, they mention the Big Bang theory as one of the miracles of the Quran because it's mentioned in an implicit way in the Quran. So they use it as an evidence of the miraculous nature of the Quran.
Fadda. This one, that one.
But Einstein. Einstein. We have a problem with Einstein.
Einstein. All of the people who believe in the Big Bang of science, they will tell you that all these law, physical laws. All you know, these matters and the physics and all the laws, for example, gravitation. This just started with that Big Bang. Before that, there is no laws.
Okay, that's the starting. How about it's not ending? The second element of the theory.
That one. You will tell you there is an end because it cannot. Because there is a beginning, there will be an end.
Okay, that's okay, fine. If that's what they are teaching in the school, but I remember what was taught at the school that energy was not created, not ending, and so on and so forth.
That's what they taught.
But no. It will be destroyed, it will be ended by the end of the universe.
Okay, just here we want to highlight that here the idea, when we understand the concepts of al-Iman, al-Tawheed within all its aspects, then we are living this dunya, we are reading books, we go to the school system, we need to open our senses, and whatever we learned, we need to learn it and criticize it, not just, you know, accepting it like this.
فضل. For the shirk, the two categories of shirk al-rububiyya.
Shirk al-rububiyya, two categories.
The deniers are not mushrikeen, they are not mushrikeen, they are deniers, they don't even
negation.
Yeah, this is a form of shirk in al-rububiyya, that they deny the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I see, okay. Okay, you know, the ulama use the word shirk kufr sometimes interchangeably.
Shirk is you are.
I understand.
Someone is there, but you.
As we said, shirk is associating, sharing, partnership. But again, ulama use the two terms, shirk and kufr, interchangeably. So that's fine.
They took their desire as a god.
As gods.
Even they deny the existence of God. But they take their desire as God. Finally.
And this is a test for us when we think about this verse. أَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَٰهَهُ هَوَاهُ. Yeah, all of us, you know, we need to challenge ourselves, examine ourselves, because we are tested. Situations where Allah says something, or our desires say something else. You know, today someone was asking me some questions around these things. And Satan comes to us and put things before our eyes as if there is only one option. If I don't, you know, there I'll be fired from work and there is no work else. That was the argument with the person I was talking to today. That, where is he? Laikun mawjood. I'm not mawjood, so I can't talk. So let's remember, it's not just one option in life. There are too many options in life. So the argument was, I can't observe prayer timely every time at work. My work will be as take and so on and so forth. Doctor, can I ask a
question? My question is about the conversation. Is it just whispers or
conversation? نسمع سؤال الدكتور يا شباب. ما سمعتش لأنهم whispering.
The story of Imam Ahmad during Salah, that he said that there is whispers from Shabbat. Is it whispers or
no
conversation?
That's Ibn Abbas.
Abbas? No, Ahmad Muhammad.
The story I mentioned, he was on the deathbed. في حضرات في سكرات الموت. يحتضر. يحتضر. So he was dying. And Satan came to him at that moment, trying to, you know, to catch him before he dies, by making him, you know, committing the sin of self-admiration. But subhanallah, Imam Ahmad was blessed by Allah. He was aware even from this little trap of shaitan. Now, تفضل أخي.
How we can make
one more minute.
How we can make the link between the covenant that you were talking about, Allah, the
I was hoping nobody to ask me this question.
And then the ayah, wa ma kunna mu'adhibina hatta nab'atha rasulan. So some people will say ajdaduna, but some people will have no one to give the meaning in the message. So how that should
come? Good question. Now, if somebody is living in a remote island where there is no internet, no TV, no radio, nothing, so he never heard about Islam and he died, okay, what will happen to those people? Or someone who's insane, so never heard of Islam in a state of sanity. Or nobody, someone living, but the message of Islam was not properly delivered to him, corrupted and distorted. Now those group of people in the hereafter, they will be tested, the Prophet ﷺ told us. So they'll be gathered in a place and Allah Azza wa Jal will come to them. Allah Azza wa Jal will come to them and will raise part of the fire and will say to them, I'm your Lord, أنا ربكم. Then Allah Azza wa Jal command them to enter that part of the fire. And those whom Allah Azza wa Jal know that they will be from among the successors, they will obey Allah and enter the fire, but it will be, you know, safe and cool for them. And those whom Allah Azza wa Jal knew in His, you know, al-ilm al-azali, that they, if they were to know about Islam, they would have, you know, acted in a disbelieving way. They will say, no, we are not entering the hellfire. So Allah Azza wa Jal tell them, I'm your Lord, I'm giving you a command, and you are disobeying me. If I were to send you a messenger, then you would have denied them and disobeyed them and so on. So that's the type of test the Prophet mentioned to them. Now back to a question, maybe in some of your minds, one of the sisters, Sayyida, asked me the same question last time. It's the same question the Sahaba asked to the Prophet ﷺ in this hadith of Adam. When the Prophet ﷺ, in part of the hadith, Allah Azza wa Jal showed Adam some light in the forehead of his offsprings. So those who are successors, who will enter Jannah, Allah Azza wa Jal placed that flashlight in their forehead. And he saw one of his children, his light was so beautiful, and asked about him. Guess who was that? I'll come to them, but I like this part. Guess who was that with the beautiful flashlight in his forehead? Dawood alayhi salam, bravo alayk, Dawood. And asked about his age, and he was told 60 years, and Adam give him 40 years from my age, so he was given 40 years from his age. When the death angel came to take the soul of Adam, Adam said to the angel, how come still there are 40 years remaining in my age? And the angel said to him, no, your age is over. Don't you remember? You gave 40 years of yours to your son, Dawood. And he said, no, I don't remember. How come? So he forgot and denied. And therefore the Prophet ﷺ said about us, his children, we forget and we deny. That's in our nature. Therefore Allah Azza wa Jal always send to the children of Adam prophets and messengers to remind them, to admonish them. And therefore there are scholars among us to remind us and admonish us. So whenever we forget or deny, hold your horses. Okay? Hold your horses. Now back to that question the Sahaba asked to the Prophet ﷺ when he told about when Adam saw part of his children will go to the Jannah, part of his children will go to the hellfire. Then the Sahaba asked, then why do we work? Why we do righteous deeds? If it was decided and decreed long time ago, before we are in the tummies of our mummies, why we pray? And the Prophet ﷺ told them that, ya jama'ah, this is about Allah Azza wa Jal to begin with gave us the power to choose, right? You chose to come here rather than staying home and sleep. You have the power to choose. Secondly, Allah Azza wa Jal sent us prophets, messengers, sent us books, showed us the way. Inna hadaynahu sabila. Imma wa imma kafura. Allah Azza wa Jal showed us the way. Then it's us who choose either the way to Allah, the path to Allah, or the path that's away from Allah. Now the issue here when it comes to that Allah Azza wa Jal knew who's in the paradise and who's in the hellfire. Ya ikhwani, that's part of ilmullah al-kamil, the complete knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because He's Allah, He's God. His knowledge is supreme, is complete, is all-encompassing. It's not just about things happening now. It's about whatever happened, what's happening, what's going to happen, what's not happening. If it were to happen, how it would happen. You know, it's about the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah Azza wa Jal is not holding us accountable against His knowledge. He's holding us accountable against the rules He sent to us, whether we obey or disobey, whether we follow or we don't follow. And that's part of the test. So this issue shouldn't confuse us. Satan should not use it to avert us away from the path of Allah Azza wa Jal. Come on, man, do whatever you want to do. If it's meant to you to be from the people of paradise, you will go there. But the Prophet ﷺ told us that those whom Allah Azza wa Jal decreed for them, written for them to be from the people of paradise, they'll be guided. Allah Azza wa Jal will help them to choose the deeds that will take them there. And those whom Allah Azza wa Jal knew that they'll be from the people of the hellfire, they'll be acting, living their lives in ways that's away from Allah. They'll make choices in this life that's disobeying. They'll be arrogant and so on and so forth. This is their choice. It's just because of Allah's complete knowledge, Allah knew it before it's happening. Shouldn't be hard to understand. It seems to me simple, and just remember, it's about the complete knowledge, the perfect knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That He knew everything before it's happening.
Like example, the teacher who knows his student before exam.
Yeah, that's...
before he gave an exam, and he wrote in a list, the one he will fail or he will succeed.
Some teachers are so good because he's a teacher.
Yeah.
Some teachers are so good, they have farasa, and they assist their students so well from the way they are interacting at class and so on and so forth, that they can predict ahead of time that this is an A plus student, this is an F, not you. Okay? And so on and so forth. Does it mean that he decided the grade ahead and you sue him? It's just he's smart enough to anticipate. So that's at the level of humans. How about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Sounds good? Faddal akhi. I can't hear you. You need to raise your voice. Yeah, it depends on the level of the love. Yeah, if some people may love for a person, a singer, or certain things in life. We mentioned the hadith, Ta'isa Abdul Dinar, Ta'isa Abdul Dirham, Ta'isa Abdul Khamisa, Ta'isa Abdul Al-Khamila. Some people love and adore shoes, for example, so much they think day and night about shoes. Willing to spend monies and wealth on shoes, and if they were to spend one third of that and one tenth of that in the cause of Allah, they will hesitate. You know, that kind of love is, you know, very serious, very in danger. Some people, their deep love of certain people in their lives, that they follow them blindly. Yeah, that's now become kind of shirk. And that's exactly what happened to the people, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله. And I refer back to what I said. I love my teacher who taught me the Quran, who taught me the Sunnah. But does that make my teacher immune from wrongdoing, from mistaken? So my love to my teacher, my Shaykh, shouldn't blind me. Okay, because my loyalty is to the book of Allah and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Therefore, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud says, "اعرفوا الرجال بالحق." Al-haq, the truth, is not recognized by people. It's the opposite. People are recognized by the truth. Sounds good? Is this statement clear? So we should fall in love with the truth, and whoever embraces the truth and presenting the truth, we follow them, we accept them, even if that was not my teacher. And that's very important. طيب جزاكم الله خيرا وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وآله وصحبه. السلام عليكم. حياكم الله يا اخي، كيفك؟
الحمد لله.
Good to see you. بارك الله فيك. حياكم الله. اي مس. وعليكم السلام. What's your name?
هذيف.
لطيف؟
هذيف.
هذيف.
Was it a shirk of tawheed? Shirk with tawheed?
Shirk is the opposite of tawheed. Tawheed means unity. Shirk means association. السلام عليكم، كيف حالك يا أخي؟
الحمد لله.
طيب إن شاء الله. حياكم الله، بارك الله فيك. السلام عليكم، كيف حالك يا أخي؟ طيب إن شاء الله، بارك الله فيك. حياكم الله.
If I the dua that Saint recited.
السلام عليكم بشير، كيف حالك؟ Wallahi, I love to. You are blessed with the masjid. The community here is amazing.
كيف حالك؟
How's the family؟
حياكم الله.
أهلا وسهلا. حياكم الله. بارك الله.
I was so sick, you know. I mean, for Hajj, but you know.
سبحان الله.
But now, Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. Sickness after Hajj, this is part of Hajj.
Is it?
All people.
Is it?
Yeah, for a month or two even.
Is it?
Yeah.
I was 3 weeks.
I kept coughing for 2 months after Hajj.
MashaAllah. Me too.
But Alhamdulillah, now I'm relieved finally.
Yeah. MashaAllah.
Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. May Allah accept from you.
Thank you very much.
Barakallah.
Nice to see you again.
It's a pleasure. Barakallah.
Mokab, right?
Huh?
You got the thing lost in the Mokab.
Assalamu alaikum.
You really got it?
I think so. He didn't send me anything.
Yeah, because I sent a text. He's already there. He said.
It seems he was waiting for someone to call him, so he has to approach them.
Yeah, but he got all the information. He can also call it there.
Good for. Okay. Barakallahu fi. Alaykum salam. Salam alaykum ya akhi. Kayfa halak? طيب ان شاء الله.
Really enjoy your.
بارك الله فيك. جزاك الله خير. بارك الله فيك. بارك الله فيك.
The one that you're asking, that
we're asking. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك أن نشرك بك شيئا نعلمه ونستغفرك لما لا نعلمه.
Where we can normally find this, like a normal, somewhere.
It's part of the dua that the Muslim good to say, to remind himself of the tawheed, seeking help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we steadfast on the tawheed and to not to commit shirk. Because as we said, shirk sometimes is very secret.
Yeah,
sometimes we are ignorant.
Without knowing
it. We may commit shirk unknowingly because we learned it from our parents. May Allah Azza wa Jalla protect us. Yeah.
Like this, especially this brother was saying, it is very common there. Like sometimes something happens, the very moment we normally forget about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Later on we remember. If something happened, we just try to praise them.
Starting from the coming lesson, we'll start talking about some of the practices in the Muslim ones that people are doing that are contrary to the tawheed. Like the charms, the omens, the fortune telling, the magic, astrology. The other day, a relative of mine was asking me about my burj, asking, do you read astrology? And she wanted to ask about which month is mine and so on and so forth. And I told her, this is a very serious issue. How come that you are? So we'll be addressing all these things that are, you know, lived by Muslims, and we need to avoid them. So from the coming lesson, we'll start talking about them one by one, inshallah. Barakallahu feekum, hayyakum Allah, hayyakum Allah. وإياك يا أخي، جزاك الله خير. What's your name, brother?
Isa.
Isa.
Yeah, from Nigeria. Yeah, like when you said talking about parents, by maybe something that we pick up from parents, it really struck me because I remember my grandfather, my son, Imam, and he used to like make dua for his grandfather or some people who have passed away around including even the prophet. But is that a shirk if you're making dua for like parents or grandmother or mother who have passed away?
Making dua for them is good, but calling on them, this is shirk.
Oh, okay.
Calling on them. For example, you say, oh, Rasulullah, I need a child, help me. Or calling on them, this is shirk in al-rububiyyah, in al-uluhiyyah, in ibadah. But making dua for the parents and the four parents, okay, making dua for them, okay, this is good.
Oh, okay. Because I just remember about when he's talking about parents, because some stuff that like people that we imitate back from home
blindly without checking. So we need to make sure.
Yeah, okay.
Keep asking. Whenever you doubt something, ask about it. بارك الله فيك يا عيسى. حياك الله بي. وعليكم السلام. ازيك؟ كيفك؟ السلام عليكم. الله يسلمك. الأردنيين عندهم هاي حلوة. سلامات.
حياك الله.
كيفك؟
الحمد لله. شو أخباركم؟
السلام عليكم. وعليكم السلام. أمين. كيف حالك؟ It's been long time. السلام عليكم. كيف حالك؟ ان شاء الله ان شاء الله. اهلين، كيف حالك يا اخي؟ طيب ان شاء الله منيح. كيف حالك انت؟ يعطيكم العافيه. الله يسلمك ويبارك فيك. حياكم الله وياكم بخير. كيف حالكم انت؟
كمتد انه يعمل اديتنج للتسجيل.
اه والله
كله بس الفجر ان شاء الله باخذهم منه.
والظاهر اذا بتعملهم كونفرتنج بدل ما الملف 5 جيج بيصير 140 كيلو.
لا
انا هيك صار معي.
معقول؟
والله ملف
هذا الشيء ساعه تقريبا دكتور. ساعه بجوز يعني بيجي يمكن 500 كيلو ولا هيك شيء. على حد اذا 8 بت تبع ال 8 بت اتس اوكي ستيل اولسو مونو.
انا مو شاطر، انا هيك جربت ملف كان ضخم جدا شيء 5 جيج. قلت له كونفرت اي في اي. ايش الاي في اي؟
بعمل مع الاي في اي يشتغل بس الكمبيوتر
بس كمان.
هي الفكرة لما تعملها converting.
The bit rate if you do it at 8 bit rate, that will be good. Mono, not